Hello, and thank you for joining us for the Pharmacy Cannabis Lecture Series. Each session is designed to deliver a small and in-depth dose of cannabis education. I'm Candace Hawes, and I want to thank all of our viewers today and all of our customers from the Pottery, the Pharmacy Santa Ana, Santa Barbara, and Berkeley for joining us today. In this session, we're going to talk about terpenes. Terpenes are naturally occurring aromatic compounds found in many plants, although many people commonly associate them with cannabis because cannabis plants contain high concentrations of terpenes in them. Cannabis researchers and consumers alike are increasingly looking at terpenes as a way to classify cannabis products and predict their effects. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Jeffrey Raber, PhD. I met Dr. Raber way back in 2010. We were just talking about this before we went live. That was their first trade show that they participated in. So it's really cool to come full circle and have him here with us today. I absolutely love working with Dr. Raber, and I know that you guys will too. Before he gets going, I wanted to give you a little just a background information on Dr. Raber. He received his BS in biochemistry from Lebanon Valley College in Pennsylvania, and subsequently a PhD in organic chemistry from the University of Southern California, with an emphasis on developing new synthetic methodologies useful in pharmaceutical drug discovery and manufacturing efforts. Dr. Raber entered the cannabis industry in 2010 and has published 5 peer-reviewed articles on cannabis topics. Dr. Raber has been invited to lecture about cannabis all around the world. He holds multiple patents on cannabis-based technologies, particularly pertaining to terpenes, and is often sought out by the press to comment on topics as he's recognized as one of the industry's scientific thought leaders, and I would definitely agree. I'm excited to have him with us today, one of my friends and longtime cannabis industry colleagues. Dr. Jeffrey Raber, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you, Candace. I appreciate the very kind introduction and am really excited to be here to discuss the very small topic of terpenes.
Awesome. Well, yeah, go ahead and get started.
Okay. What are terpenes and why are they important in cannabis? It's, as we mentioned, a very, very broad topic. And you gave a very nice background on myself. And I just wanted to kind of say it's not only me. There are a team of experts behind me, a lot of folks, some that I went to graduate school with and some that I found along the way in this endeavor. But they've been with me for a long time. And it really is a group effort. You know, we all like to work together. We all contribute in different ways, but we are foundationally, we're chemists at heart. So we're molecule types. We like to, you know, understand which molecules are doing what. And we kind of followed our chemical nose soon after getting started to say it's more than just cannabinoids. There are these other things that are kind of driving what we believe may be the effects. So let's go start testing for terpenes. And we were the first commercial lab of some sort to start testing for terpenes in 2011. It's always fun to tell the story that we had to give the testing for that away for about 6 months and get them all over labels until everyone started to say, are you not just charging me for some other test you concocted there, scientist? Or are these things really important to us? And, you know, no one really understood why we might have embarked on that in 2011. But I think today many people may be familiar with, you know, terpenes. And hopefully through this type of educational effort, we can get many more understanding why they may be important in the cannabis products. So our first poll question, you know, just kind of, and forgive me for being a scientist, but I'm going to ask some curiosity questions about the, you know, the audience here, trying to understand, you know, have you heard about cannabis terpenes before? Before that you saw about this presentation, most likely, you know, yes, that you're here, but I'm kind of curious, like what we might get from some of the folks. It's a broad topic, right? And I think we'll talk where we see terpenes and everything else, but it's some other data has said that there's really been very few, I'd say, types of consumers or patient populations that really understand terpenes or are familiar with them. As low as 30% of some of the folks going into some dispensaries had said they were somewhat familiar with them. So that means 70% didn't hear about it, need to be educated. And I think that was a pretty significant number. You know, I was a little shocked when I heard about that one.
And our poll people, our audience is weighing in. If you click over to polls, you can see the results yourself. And we have 100% of our guests today have heard about terpenes, but they're going to learn a lot more today.
Okay, good. Yeah, we'll see how much they've learned about, or know about them before we get started. And then, you know, where they are at, hopefully by the end of it. So, you know, why are terpenes important in cannabis? I think it's important to say what's in cannabis. And there are certainly a large number of molecules present and known to be present on cannabis, either made by cannabis or are degradants of cannabis. You can have like thermal degradation or oxidative degradation, and different molecules, you know, may be found certainly on different cultivars or in different products. So there's a little bit of the idea of, you know, there are probably close to 1,300 different molecules. Not every cultivar and not every product has that many on there. There's actually a lot lower number. And that number does include things like cellulose and, you know, amino acids and all sorts of fats and waxes and other molecules that we don't talk that much about. But, you know, I don't think it's not fair to discount any of them, right? We don't know what's driving which effects. We can say in some forms we're only taking certain ones. We are, you know, more likely to consume larger amounts of them in different delivery methods. So you're not consuming all of those every single time unless you are directly eating the plant, which I will say is a viable method of consumption as well. And the major classes are the cannabinoids and terpenes, but flavonoids are probably the one that's, you know, going to start to make a little bit more noise in the not too distant future too. But we have predominantly talked about a couple cannabinoids, right? Like THC, then there's CBD, and then there's their acids, cannabinoid acids, THCA and CBDA. But yet there are well over 100 of those. So we have a lot to explore and understand with that. There was CBG seminars a little bit earlier today. I don't know if anyone's tuned into those, but I think we're starting to understand there are a lot of other cannabinoids. And then there are all these terpenes, right? So there are very many of them, terpenes and terpenoids. A terpene, to a poor chemist like myself, it's repeating isoprene units. So what's isoprene? It's a very small building block the plant uses to go as its starting point to making higher functionalized molecules. When you add anything other than carbon and hydrogen, such as oxygen or sulfur or other heteroatoms, then we call them terpenoids. So those are, you know, we kind of broaden the term terpene in the cannabis world to include maybe some molecules that don't meet that chemical definition. But it's the place that we'll kind of start to have the conversation. And I've listed just a few of the basic ones there, and we'll talk a little bit more about some of the more common ones as well. I think it's really important, you know, why are we having any of this conversation? We kind of have a good understanding that if it's just one molecule pulled out of the plant, like THC, or CBD, it's not found to be as effective as when you have many more of these. And this is what we kind of call in the industry the entourage or ensemble effect. I prefer the ensemble word because it means all of them are important. There's not one leader of the pack and the other ones are following along. It really is all of those that kind of come together and say, this composition is important for these particular patients or these uses. We know this because we have single molecule pharmaceuticals or even just two molecules. So Marinol is synthetic THC. It's high purity THC, exact same type of molecule you'd find in the plant. And it's not wildly effective for a wide number of folks. It has some utility. It certainly has helped a number of people as an antiemetic. But it's not often as favorably, I'd say, received as whole plant cannabis. So there's a lot more going on when you add all the other molecules. Another step in that direction is Sativex. It's a THC, about 1-to-1, 2.7 to 2.5 milligrams THC to CBD. GW Pharmaceutical has that one, and they've found some effectiveness in pain for MS patients, but they have run many, many other clinical trials and not seen broadly, you know, applicable efficacy. Whereas, you know, many of us in the medical cannabis community will say, well, we see lots of patients of different types finding benefits from these whole plant products. Ruth Galili in Israel also did some great work where they said, hey, CBD by itself might help a very, very small number of folks. But if we have a broad, you know, whole plant CBD based extract, we see much broader physiological utility. So these kind of things kind of lend us all to say, the closer we get to whole plant, the closer we get to more of the molecules in the plant, the more likely we are able to derive beneficial effects to a broader percentage of the population. It may be as horrifying as exactly one specific chemical composition for a patient, you know, but that composition, while it may help that one, hopefully it will help many others. but that may not be the case. And I think that is, you know, the cannabis challenge. What really is going to help the broadest number of folks or be the right medicine for each individual? It's very difficult to kind of navigate the waters. And hopefully the information today will help patients guide themselves a little bit to what they can look for and how they might actually get there. The world of cannabis is, you know, exceptionally complex, from many different product types to their different uses. And they all have different modes of ingestion, different absorptivities, different types of molecules that will get there. I probably see different concentrations enter my body if I take the exact same concentrate and compare it, whether I orally consume it or if I'm going to inhale it. So even if I'm holding the same thing, but I consume it in two different ways, topical might be the other extreme, I'm going to get very different molecule blood concentrations, which could drive different effects. So, you know, we're going to speak in generalities today. We're not speaking about a specific, you know, formally clinically studied composition. And it's very, you know, I would just want to caution, it is more of a generality. Like, how do you find the right thing for you? One, you got to be comfortable with the way you're going to want to take it. And if you're not finding that initial step as being comfortable, maybe you need to try some other means of ingestion. And then I think the biggest question from a patient perspective is, how consistent is this product? If it's consistent, you know, then I can say it's going to deliver the same thing to me no matter how I choose to use it or how much I choose to use it. I can titrate myself if they give me the same thing every single time. And unfortunately, giving you the same thing every single time in the world of cannabis is also exceptionally complex because we're going to try to do it with, you know, 100 molecules or more. And that's definitely no easy task, right? Most pharmaceuticals are one, maybe two or three. But when you start to get to many, many ingredients, the complexity is very challenging. I will assure you it's doable, but it's definitely not easy, nor not for those that are experienced or really watching the details very, very well. What we see in the market today, there's a couple of cannabinoids, like I was mentioning, THC acid, THC, CBD acid, CBD. We're starting to see CBG acid and CBG, and then CBN, Delta 8 THC, I probably could have added to the list. That's a more popular one as well now.
Yeah,
certainly rising in popularity. We see them in, you know, different ratios. They can be formulated. You can get them as individual ingredients. So you could have, you know, high concentrations like 20 to 1 or 1 to 20. You can have 1 to 1. You can have 1 to 1 to 1 to 1. You know, there are very many different compositions that can be made. Again, try to see the label and try to see if that producer is doing that production consistently. That is kind of a really big piece of the puzzle. The term I said terpenes, we kind of use that as the broad-based term for these smaller molecules, these aromatic hydrocarbon-based molecules that impart effect and flavor. So they are important towards taste, but they are very important towards driving some of the effect as well. And then, you know, there's some other stuff in there, right? Like, we don't always have 100% high purity ingredients. We don't always have every single molecule perfectly defined, and we're only using four things, right? That we may have a crude extract. We may have extracts that are 90%, and there's some other things. It's not always reported or found from the lab. That doesn't mean that it's not consistent. It just means that it's not going to be on your label. And it may not be something that's watched very carefully. So there are things like fats, waxes, plant sterols, other flavonoids. And depending upon the manufacturing process and depending on how you get there, that will be, you know, consistent or not consistent and what plant material they may be coming from. So I don't think we're seeing huge variability in those departments that are causing wildly different effects, but they may have effects that are different for some people. Again, if there's like one specific composition for one individual, those pieces that we're, you know, not testing for but are actually there may be causing some of that variability. And if you're starting to get frustrated, but you feel like it was mostly the same, maybe it's one of those things the lab's not quite reporting yet. In an analytical sense, we can only tell you what we're looking for. So if we target that, you know, analytical perspective and say, let's go quantify, you know, THC, CBD, and CBN. Great, we can tell you that. But we, if we're not looking for Delta 10 THC or some other cannabinoids, they may be present and they wouldn't be reported nor on the label. It's impossible to tell a lab, tell me everything that's in here. and then give them a, you know, 500 compound mixture and say, what's there? It would take a very, very long time and too much, you know, money and time to really get there. So that's not how the lab works, but let's not have that really, you know, hopefully not frustrate anyone. And I thought, you know, a little background on what are we kind of talking about here in terms of which system is actually at play. The endocannabinoid system wasn't in my books in school. I hope I'm not dating myself too much, but everyone knows I've been around here for a while now. So I did leave school a little while ago. And there were, you know, other pieces related to this. So the endocannabinoids, anandamide and arachidonic acid are linked to arachidonic acid. And we saw leukotrienes and lipoxins as two legs of the stool. The third ones are the endocannabinoids. But the endocannabinoid system wasn't described in my, you know, textbooks. It's still not described in many medical systems today. It's only been more recently discovered, and because of all the challenges with going about, you know, investigating anything cannabis related, it's been a little slower to develop. But what we're starting to see is this is a gigantic network. So every time you go to another presentation later down the road, we've seen someone add another slide, another set of receptor molecules, and I've listed a couple of other ones here. You know, like fatty acid amide hydrolase is what breaks down anandamide back to its starting components. And while the biologists keep saying, here's other letters, I guess we gave up calling them cannabinoid one and two. We just said, you know, they're either here, but they are interacting with cannabinoids. And they may interact with terpenes in different ways. And we have really not begun to unravel much of that at all. So there is a whole lot that's going to kind of, you know, come about in different ways as we go further and further down the system. And this is just the kind of the biochemist or biologist view of what's a little bit at play in this system. Vincenzo DiMarzo over in Italy has been doing a lot of this work. And this slide is from 2008. Now he's got another slide and it's a whole another set of receptors. But I think that the takeaway message is this is a system of balance. There's a complex set of interactions. There's a number of different receptors, a lot of molecules. It's not one lock and key, right? It's not one key that I'm trying to find for one lock. It's much more complicated than that, which, you know, is going to lend towards two pieces. One, complexity is challenging to try and discern and really understand ourselves and help people find the right thing for them. But because it's so complex, we probably have great hope that everybody could find something for them. So it kind of goes both ways, but it is definitely a little bit of a challenge when you're trying to navigate it for your own medical needs. And some terms that you'll see, ECS, endocannabinoid system, it is key to regulating the body's, you know, fundamental homeostasis. How do I stay in balance? And many folks here know it's been, you know, a key piece of many different ailments or many different things that we might need, like good sleep and pain protection, neuroprotection, reducing anxiety, or, you know, just inflammation in general, which could be the root of so many different things. Importantly, terpenes also exhibit some of these cannabimimetic effects. So this was very recently published. I've got the article link there for everyone. And they're starting to say, hey, we're now starting to unravel that some terpenes can impact this endocannabinoid system as well. So this is super exciting to see the biologists finally, you know, start to say, yep, these things are doing what we would have always kind of suspected in some ways. In the body and in the system, we're not sure because there are so many of them and so many different compositions and mixtures, how they all may work together. And I think it's important to know, like, some may, you know, elevate the interaction, some may downregulate. So you may turn on or turn off different things. It's not just this one does this and it does it all the time. It's This one may do this in this case if nothing else is there to cancel it. And we really don't know much about what may cancel which ones just yet. So that's definitely a big part of the complexity that we don't have a solid handle on, and I'm not going to kid anybody about that one.
That's so interesting. That's really interesting. Yeah, hearing that.
Yeah. There are probably two different extremes in terms of cannabinoid syndromes. One is deficiency. That might be why a lot of folks are here. Like, my body doesn't produce enough endocannabinoids for all the external stressors or things that are causing me to be in disease or out of balance. So if I can introduce exogenous cannabinoids into my body, I might give it some more tools to help, you know, balance itself. I think the easiest way to think, like, why would that be helpful, is if you see someone fail a, you know, THC drug test, you know, 30 days after use, that's your body saying, I'm holding on to this for using it in small places in small amounts of time, but I didn't say clear it because I thought it was all useless. I thought it was pretty effective, and I'm going to harness that and kind of tuck it away in my fat storage system before I let it go. That is very much unlike a lot of other molecules that we know. Those things get cleared rapidly in you know, a matter of days because your body's like, don't need more of it, get it out of here. And I always found that to be an interesting piece. So if you are deficient, you know, you might not need to take it every day, or you might need a little bit, and a little bit can go a very long way. It is multimodal in that there are many different dosing regimens that may cause different effects of even the exact same medicine. So I always think, put the med back in medicine, the minimum effective dose, keep the medicine amount low, and try and go low and, you know, start slow. So work your way up to what is most effective. It isn't always more is better. And hyperemesis kind of tells us more can be a problem. So hyperemesis is when your body's kind of overwhelmed with too much cannabinoids, and it just starts to violently cause you to vomit all the time. And it is really a rather horrifying condition. And I think it's important that we also talk about it. There can be too much of a good thing as well. So just like I can never do it with water, you know, I can never do it with, you know, the wrong concentrations of oxygen. There are way too many things can happen when I have too much. And cannabinoids and, you know, cannabis in general can be that way as well. So monitor your use, make sure it's not going to excessive extremes, and really, you know, be careful with that, because it can be a habitual problem. Even if you are still feeling physiological benefit, you don't want it to become a habit that you feel like you have to do it all the time. And because your body's storing it, you know, you might not have to do it that day, and you'd still feel a lot of the benefits the day after. Again, those are all individualized things, but I think it is important to kind of highlight, hey, some of these are, you know, happening. Those are the extremes. Someone might not have any and they need a lot. Someone might get too much and feel really, really sick and have thrown their endocannabinoid system out of balance. So that's kind of, you know, cannabis fundamentals to try and set up what we were doing with terpenes. And well, as I had mentioned, we were the first lab in 2011 to say, let's start looking at these other molecules, like literally followed our chemical nose and said, I see a chromatogram for cannabinoids, and it is all the same. Like I could literally stack, you know, three of these things on top of themselves, and I'm not seeing a difference. Now, I'm not looking at every single minor cannabinoid like we may be doing today with mass spectrometry. So, you know, but these are generally the same, but we're getting wildly different reports of what's going on, and they'll smell different and they taste different. So let's start analyzing, you know, these smell molecules per se, which are what we call today the terpenes. And there was a very early kind of graphical representation or a way of saying, hey, for some of these, we think bar charts might be helpful. You can kind of stack your reports together. Displaying these things graphically and helping everyone talk about them is still a considerable challenge. I think we're all still trying to wrestle with how do we take, you know, hundreds of data points or complexity pieces and make that something easily represented. We don't need labels that are accordions, you know, 6-7 pages of data. No one's going to read that or understand it. Leafly's trying to come up with some pictorial ways of doing it. You'll see different labs with different types of diagrams. And I don't know if there's a great answer for everybody, but I think we're all going to keep trying until we see the market reward some good approaches towards graphically representing this complex data set. So terpenes are produced in the trichomes, and they can mostly be found on the surface of the plant. The plant is producing these to kind of communicate with its environment, communicates with its other cannabis plants. It will attract friendly insects. It will ward off pests this way. It doesn't make them for us. Like I don't think it made them for us. It didn't know that we'd really want this one. Now that's a, you know, maybe it's evolved to that point where it's like, I know you guys are going to like these more than the others. You know, The Botany of Desire, great movie and book. You should definitely check that out. I really enjoyed the PBS documentary, What Plants Talk About. And it kind of speaks to how they use this molecular world to communicate with each other. And terpenes are a huge part of that. So, you know, when you can smell them off the plant, they're dissipating away from just the surface of the plant. And they really speak to how they will molecularly communicate within the environment. I always see myself like a kind of chemical translator. You know, we're trying to see what are they producing and why. And then we're trying to say, well, how can we use that for us? But that isn't always why they're producing them for themselves. And definitely very, very different types of concentrations, different types of profiles. And it's important to say both marijuana and hemp, they are all cannabis. We have legal labels, tax labels, scientifically, and from any consumer perspective, it's all cannabis sativa L. So it is, you know, one plant with many species and many subspecies underneath it, many different varietals inside of there, and they can have almost an infinite number of possibilities within constraints in terms of which enzymes might be expressed and be able to produce which molecules. But we do see a lot of opportunity for many different compositions. Another piece is, are they psychoactive? And, you know, yes, they can certainly change your brain activity. They can change your perception of things. Scent memory is a fantastic one. Like if I can smell things, it might take me back to something that happened a long time ago. I often think of pie when that one comes up, right? You guys have some wonderful holidays. They're around the corner, so things to look forward to. But are they all psychotropic? You know, psychedelic, psychotropic, psychoactive. These are different words and different definitions for those words. Psychotropic is the modulation of mood, behavior, thought, or the perception of them. So are they all driving that? Not necessarily, but can some? Yes. So again, this word terpene is huge, and you probably have it, you know, generate a molecule that will fall within most of every definition that we will come up with. So be careful when you talk in a broad sense about those. These are some of the common terpenes that we find in cannabis. And I think the interesting piece is these are found in many, many other plants. So what I've listed here is some of the other plants that a few of them may be prevalent in. An easy one is limonene. It's the large part of this, you know, citrus essential oils. It can be over 90% of the citrus essential oil. So it's prevalent in, you know, your fruits, orange, limes, lemons, things like that. Alpha-humulene is in hops. Lavender has linalool. And, you know, caryophyllene is maybe common to some people from black pepper. We do have olfactory training kits. You know, I'm sure labs will give you some different stuff if you wanted to try and go smell some of these in an individual sense. It's very interesting to smell one by itself and see if you can pick it out of a complex mixture. It's almost impossible for myself. I'm not very good at that. Some people are really, really good at that. But when you put them all together, they kind of, you know, seem a little different in smell than just maybe one molecule at a time. The other ones like terpinolene, pinenes, alpha and beta pinenes, and even myrcene. Myrcene is present in mango and can be very common in, you know, fruits. We can see a lot of different types of effects that come from that. Sorry, one second.
No problem. We all have little ones
running in to see what's going on. I think the important piece of this is how are all these working together to drive those ensemble effects? And I think, you know, I thought it would be interesting to try and put up some of the other terpenes that are present inside of cannabis. I'm not going to try and humiliate myself by trying to pronounce them all. You can have fun trying to do that at home or ask your friends to do it. It's really quite the challenge to talk about these things. So what we put after these are their chemical abstract number. And this is kind of like the VIN number or the barcode kind of piece to a molecule so that you're sure you're talking about the exact same molecule and not just, you know, something that may be like that or a mixture of those. So it's, you know, the chemistry world's very complex. And I just thought it'd be fun to kind of throw up some of these names and say, wow, like there are definitely many of them inside of the plant and many different ones. That kind of brings us to, you know, the next polling question. Do you guys have a favorite terpene out of this group? Was there, you know, one or two that you might prefer over another? I don't think we asked, you know, we're not going to specifically ask why. That would probably take way too long to dive into. But there are lots and lots of, you know, different ones. These are pretty common, right? We see, we do see the patterns that a lot of cultivars have similar commonalities. What's interesting is not a lot of them have terpinolene. So that is one that's kind of to a different subset, which I'll talk about in a little bit. But it's not always, you know, not always present in everyone, whereas caryophyllene will be in like every single one. So it is interesting how we're starting to see some of the diversity play out.
And it looks like the winner is limonene.
Okay. Yeah. That one's very present in almost all of them as well. It's very prevalent. And I think it's one of the top ones in a lot of cultivars. So you may have seen them on labels. It's one we're familiar with from all the citrus. So it's not too surprising. And it is pleasant, right? I mean, that's why they put it in household cleaners. It's not only, you know, useful as a cleaner, but it's also, you know, prevalent. And like, we kind of generally like that, I think, for most folks. And I thought, you know, what do we think we know? And what might you hear that, you know, we know? I will not pretend to know much of anything. I like to think that we might have some fundamental understanding, but I'm always open-minded that someone's going to change my mind, that there's going to be some new data piece that says you were wrong about what you had assumed before. Dark matter is kind of a fun one to talk about in that one. Like, we thought we knew the universe, and then you have, like, you know, how much of it don't we know? And then do we, you know, it's a very fun type of thing to say, what do you know? So that's why I clarify that with what we think we know today. So we think, you know, there's this indica sativa type of designation, and that there's, you know, indica sativa and hybrid. So there were only three things, and that you'll get only these three types of effects, right? Like up, down, and somewhere in the middle. Well, is there one in the middle, or are there many in the middle, right? So, you know, just thinking that there's three words, meaning there's only three types of things, tells you that's probably not the case. It's much more complicated than that, unfortunately. And what I think we really do need to know, what we've seen is John McPartland did some fantastic work called DNA barcoding and how they can sequence the genomes of the plants and start to tell you if they are related or closely related or how they may, you know, be brothers, sisters or not related at all. And it told us that really sativa and indica are subspecies of Cannabis sativa L. And you know, I was excited when I heard that because I was like, thankfully, the law says Cannabis sativa L. So if there really was like a Cannabis sativa L and a Cannabis indica L, what do we do with all the indica plants? And are they currently illegal? Like, that would be horrifying. So fortunately, no, we don't have to worry about that one. Like, at least according to this data, it says they're all supposed to be classified under Cannabis sativa L, subspecies sativa, subspecies indica. There may be some other subspecies that, you know, we're not in the study or that we're aware of. But it's, you know, it says, hey, look, we didn't even really have that piece kind of classified, right? As new scientific tools and efforts come about, we've classified it differently. We may choose to classify them differently down the road as well. And these are morphological and biological definitions. They don't necessarily directly translate to us in a physiological sense and what we're going to be feeling. So, you know, you might still see these labels. They're going to persist for quite some time. They're going to be around, like it or not. They may be helpful for some people saying, hey, this is driving somewhat up and this is driving somewhat down for a bulk of the population. So I don't want to completely discount it, but it is probably not the best way to classify cannabis going forward. I wouldn't say that we have the best way of doing that yet either, but we definitely, you know, are working on new ways of doing that. Importantly, I want to say, like, when you process the plant, I mean, because this was DNA from the plant, when you process that, you're changing the chemistry significantly, right? You're changing concentrations of many molecules. Your goal is to change the concentration of something like THC or the major cannabinoid. Well, you're changing a lot of the terpenes too. Some disappear, some are there in very different concentrations. Some have changed into other molecules the plant doesn't produce. So the same name of the same product, and I'll highlight this a little later too, doesn't necessarily mean the same composition. And I'll leave that at that point for now, but I'll talk more about that later with a hopefully a nice graphical picture. We had taken a pretty large data set that we had, and back in 2015 kind of did what's called principal component analysis on that data set to analyze how tightly clustered might these groups be. So you take all your data points, you weight each one of those, and you try and say, can I pull the data apart as much as possible? And in doing so, this is like a slice out of a three-dimensional picture, how might they cluster? And if they cluster, I can assume that they're similar in chemical composition. And, you know, we had red for hybrid, blue for sativa, green for indica. And what you see is, you know, maybe there's like two types of clusters here. There's like a continuum and another set of clusters. And there were different molecules pulling those apart in some ways, but it didn't didn't squarely come up with sativa, indica, and hybrid, right? Which is, if that world was perfect, that is exactly what you would have seen. Yep. So what we were saying was, man, the names are a mess. You know, would the real OG Kush please stand up, because we're not sure where that one is. And you can see, you know, Trainwreck at the very bottom is definitely not like the ones at the top. And Trainwreck, Jack Hare, things like that, they really have a unique, they have the higher terpenylene profiles. That one is definitely pulling those, that group away. They are somewhat different. And even our data set, I'll just say this was our data set. This doesn't represent the entire cannabis world. This is not the end all be all to all things cannabis. Whenever you see any laboratory talking about their data, it is their data that they got. It doesn't mean that they scoured the world or the universe and took, you know, a million samples across the globe and here's what the picture of cannabis looks like. It's what does their data say? And in this case, you know, back in 2015 people were giving us what they wanted to have tested. It wasn't what you see today. It all has to be tested. So that's a very different perspective. These are ones people thought were good. These were ones that we hand selected, like in taking the sample. So we were sure the data was at least accurate from the bag perspective. But they were labeled with whatever anybody else had labeled them along the way. So this is what a consumer was seeing at that point in time, because it was presented to a dispensary, but it wasn't necessarily what even the cultivator might have called it, because two or three other guys along the way might have changed the name so they could sell it to the dispensary at that time. And really, it's like a long-winded way of saying it was quite a mess. and it still is a little bit of a mess today, unfortunately. So what is this type of, you know, chemotyping tell us? Like, what is it really helping us understand? It tells us that we really need to not think of the plant's morphology and driving physiological effects, but try and understand the molecules that are present to help us discern which products might be right for us. And I'm assuming that, you know, most of the folks here in California, it is not mandatory to test for terpenes in our regulated system. If you're going to make claims about terpenes, you have to test for those, but it is not required. States like Nevada, Connecticut, they require terpene testing on their products, which is very helpful, I think, to the consumers. I don't know if they're all required to be labeled, though, which, you know, where's the data? Is it helpful to the consumer in that fashion? But, you know, a lot of us are aware, marketing groups are trying to talk, how do I differentiate myself? I think we're going to get more and more terpene information about our products. Labs are certainly capable to test for a pretty broad number of them. I want to say like 35 or so, somewhere between 30 and 50 is going to be pretty common for most testing labs today. And I think we still have the question of like, well, how many of these do we need to understand to get the right compositions for ourselves? It is by far a community-based effort. Like, not one person, not one group is going to figure all this out. We really do need to kind of work together to get there. What we're starting to see, because we are getting more data, we are seeing more testing happen, and how do we get you know, more labs talking about this, we're starting to see things in different groups. So we are starting to say, like, hey, within at least high THC cultivars, we're starting to see maybe 6 to 8 major classes. Myrcene, caryophyllene, limonene, terpenylene, osamine, pinene. These are ones that they may be highest in that terpene, many other differentiated pieces behind that. So this is the first attempt of saying, hey, this is a bunch of THC with this as the dominant terpene, but I'm not sure if the next 2, 3, 4, 5, or, you know, X number of those after that are always the same, nor may be driving the same effects. But we are starting to see pretty good numbers, you know, of groupings of this type. So SC Labs shared some lab data with through the Emerald Cup, and they were saying, I think 42% of what their lab had seen had high myrcene content. So again, I'll say that this is what that lab has seen. It's not always representative of even everything in California. But they were starting to say, you know, I think if we start to see enough labs say, hey, let's compare some insights, what are you seeing in a general sense? We're starting to see some classifications come about through a major terpene. Great first step. Not the end of the game, but at least it's getting us there. And maybe some people can put a couple on the label. When we started testing, we tried to put as many as we could on there. 3, 5, 7, I think, are probably any is better than zero. And, you know, we did see some folks saying, I kind of like it when these three are near the top for me. So maybe, you know, 3 is enough. But I don't think we know yet. So I think it's, you know, one question is, does cannabis really work that way for everybody? You know, or are we all just here, you know, filling the internet with, you know, useless information or just talking about things in general? Does it, like, do these different product compositions cause different effects for folks? You know, I think most all of us are going to answer yes. That's probably why we're curious about which cannabis is right for us. It's not just any cannabis. But there are folks that would have said before, or some states are still saying, we don't think there's any need for those things. We don't know that why there would have to be more than two different products out here, because it's all the same, right? And I do have a rather entertaining slide with that one coming up next. Like, is it really all the same? Thankfully, everyone here thinks, you know, no, it is not all the same. But, you know, Vice thought in 2018, they thought, nope, still all the same. So there you go. More evidence. It's all the same. And I, you know, my head literally exploded when I saw this, at least on the inside. You know, like, are you kidding me? Like, you can't have a headline like that. Like, did you talk to any scientists whatsoever? You certainly didn't talk to us before you printed this one. And, you know, even if you're like, we're not sure if it's all the same, would have been a better headline than we think it's all the same. Because obviously it's not. I mean, it's definitely chemically not. We don't think that it's helping only one type of specific patient population. And, you know, I think it's just very frustrating from a scientific standpoint and a general consumer standpoint. Like, how do we see a headline like this? It's very unfortunate. I think we, all of us here at least, and many of us today say, like, we know that's not the case. And it's, you know, now we can kind of chuckle about it. But if this is driving policy and if this is driving consumer choices, you know, can we scrub it from the internet? Because it really was wrong. And you don't see them published like, oops, sorry, I was incorrect and I want to change my headline. That seems to be a lot harder to get done than, you know, ever, you know, impacting any article like that. This is a nice slide that was kind of representing, you know, how names can be misleading. This is data from DigiPath Labs in Nevada. So the same product, you know, they did terpene profiling, same labs doing the terpene profiling. And they said, here's diamond dust in the flower, and here's the resulting concentrate that was formed from that. I believe this one's a rosin product. Pictorially, you can see those two are not the same graphic. So obviously those are not the same chemical compositions, and would they cause the same effects? They may or they may not for some folks. But if you're wondering, why did my, you know, concentrate product or live resin product from this not impact me the same way? It very well may be because your terpene profile is different. As I was mentioning, your extraction methods will change that chemical composition. And here's two more examples. These are live resin extracts. So take the flower, do a, you know, live resin hydrocarbon extraction, put the, you know, concentrate product out there, or even put it in a vape pen. And what you're seeing is very different chemical composition. So without trying to confuse you with all the names and the numbers and saying, do they look the same? You know, these little lifesavers are kind of telling us, like, well, that pictorially doesn't look the same to me. I don't know if this picture is worth 1,000 words, but it certainly starts to tell you, hey, there's something going on. Should we, you know, be very careful if we say this is Durban Poison's live resin, and it's not just Durban Poison, the flower. I'll also say that two people may grow Durban Poison, and they may grow it very differently, and the flower may have very different chemical profiles as well. So it's very important to kind of say, like, all right, this might be what that was called, but what molecules are being mapped to that? What's chemically present in my hand, and how am I going to consume that as to how I might be able to predict the effects? I like to say, like, some folks probably are okay with physiological roulette if they're just having fun. Like, that might be fine. But if you're a medical patient that is really in need, or someone seeking a consistent, you know, result, it's really important that we drive into these details and start to say, here's how we unlock some of the medical potential of cannabis for as many folks as possible. It's not just, let's call it all the same because that's a popular name and should get it to move off the shelf. Like, how can we make this different? How can we enable consumers to kind of get better information so they can make a more informed choice? You know, I'm often asked, like, does the source of a terpene matter when you go and make products? And I don't think source of it matters, you know, cannabis derived versus botanical terpenes versus a synthetic terpene. Consistency in formulation is far more important than anything else. And what is the purity of the molecules going in there so that you can understand, is that the same? And would there be anything that may or may not cause harm? So cannabis-derived terpenes, you can give it to a lab and they can probably identify 40 to 50% of those terpenes after the fact because they've changed so much in that isolation process. And you're oxidizing them, you're isomerizing them, they're new molecules, they may not be natural products themselves. So just because it came from a source doesn't mean it's okay. And just because it's naturally derived doesn't mean it's okay. Ricin is naturally derived and it's a very toxic poison as well. So, you know, the word natural, you know, the word botanical terpene meaning natural, I think it is important to say, hey, look, here's where I got those, but does that always mean it's what I need? And is it better for me? Or is it even quote unquote safe? That's a very tricky word with a very, very broad and vast definition and one that, you know, many people sue each other over all the time. It's very, very challenging to kind of understand what is meant by that. But when we talk about an inhalation product, it is probably very important to understand what molecules are going into that and what are we introducing into our airways? How might vape hardware and other pieces kind of impact that toxicological profile of that? If you stay closer to the plant, we'll probably have a better idea that we're going to be in a realm that we haven't seen adverse events from before, because we've been combusting those products for quite some time. I think that's how we kind of can say, hey, look, you know, we're okay with where we're at today. We've run this large experiment and we didn't have a lot of people harmed from cannabis itself. Now, if we're adding things, something like vitamin E acetate, that caused a huge problem. That was, you know, major culprit in the E-Valley scare at the end of 2019. How do we avoid those types of problems? How do we stay away from that? We stay closer to the plant. And this picture here is how we deploy our technology. We take the map of the plant's picture. What is the chemical profile there? And how do we recreate that with individual molecules at high purity to say this is going to give us that same chemical profile? And then I can kind of take, you know, from the plant and put it together with the cannabinoids and say this consistent composition is going to be delivering the same, you know, at least effects to you if you use it the same every single time. So trying to control as many molecules as possible, making sure you got a great view and perspective on your supply chain, and really saying, you know, how do we get consistency to the consumer? That's a big piece of what we're trying to do by offering formulations to many folks all the time. So where do we take like all this info today? What can consumers and patients do? You know, different states are going to require different testing regimes, different things on the label. Just try to use as much info as you can. Try and get your hands on all of it. The C of A should be available. You mm-hmm. should be able to find that information. I know some folks that are going around asking for them, and they're usually getting a pretty cold shoulder at most dispensaries. It's a time-consuming endeavor, but I think, you know, we can thank the pandemic for QR code adoption. I think we're going to see more of these. You know, we don't want to thank it for much, but maybe that's one thing that would be like, great, technology advancements have happened to where we can disseminate larger amounts of information in more rapid times. So getting access to these things via QR codes are probably there. Some states don't allow you to smell the product anymore. Your nose is a very sensitive detector. It's a great olfactory detector. You can kind of discern. And some folks that have seen lots of cannabis are amazing at it. Where they're like, nope, that's not the same thing that you called it last time because it smells different. And very subtle changes that may be hard to detect in the analytical lab can be present to the nose because it's so, so sensitive. So trust your nose, right? Like you're like, hey, everything looked the same, but I got home and something just wasn't right. Or I had a little bit left over from the last batch. I tried this one. They're not quite matching up. You know, concentration can be a delicate piece there. So be careful like how you do it. But, you know, trust your nose. If you're like, hey, I might get some different effects. Okay, I did. Well, let's go back. Maybe I'll try the next batch, but I didn't want that batch. So pay attention to batch numbers and lot numbers and just try to do your very best from an informed perspective.
Yeah. And we've been buying with our nose all these years. You know, that's why we went into dispensaries. And this one smells good. Yep. When I had one that smelled this way before, it made me feel good. And you have that memory, that smell memory, and you remember this smell makes me feel a good way. So we've been, you know, really kind of thinking about terpenes without even knowing it.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Right. They're all around us, right? And in many different products and everything, but certainly in cannabis. And I think, you know, smelling the jar was a great piece. We cannot do that from like communicable disease perspective, unfortunately. Yeah. There are some innovative approaches of like, here's a smell jar, I'll throw this away, or a little bit that we can, you know, kind of replicate in ways to get there. But I, you know, you're going to kind of be stuck with that one at home and literally holding the bag, unfortunately, in some bad experiences. But it's an interesting data point and one you should recognize and be aware of. We're, you know, just trying to limit variability of these products. They're agricultural products to start with. You know, someone might have had the same genetic stock and they grew it outdoor and next season was different, much like the same with the wines. Indoor cultivation efforts could have been different than the outdoor ones. Even the same genetics going in different cultivation environments can produce different chemical profiles. One of our friends in the audience sent me a wonderful article last night that we really are buying cannabis based on terpenes. A lot of genomic analysis is now saying, you know, there's a lot of similarities here, but we really haven't discerned based on genetics. We've based it on terpenes. And like you were saying, we were smelling a lot of these things. We're trying to understand what those molecules, you know, were telling us in an olfactory sense to make our selection. And I'm just a big fan of saying, we don't know. We don't know much today. I don't know why that's never rewarded. It's like a shame that you're like, hey, we don't know much. Like COVID happened. It's just starting. We don't know much. We're going to learn more as we go. A good, you know, honest message is, here's what I know today. And here's what I think I might know as well. But it may change. And we might not know everything. And we certainly don't know everything today, not in the world of cannabis. But hopefully we're starting to learn enough of trying to guide folks in good directions. Start with diverse products. Find what works for you and kind of narrow yourself into that you know, effective window and just try and ask as many questions. If your bud tender is different than you, that's fine. If they're like a complete opposite, it's a great way of saying, well, did you like this? No, but I did. So, okay, which one did you not like as well? I'll go try that one. Or which ones do you really like? I'll stay away from them. So you don't have to be like everyone else to find your way, but a good open communication and good honest marketing behind here's what we know about our products, I think is going to take us hopefully a lot further than, you know, where we had been before. And that's kind of the end of the slides. We can kind of open it up to questions and answers and see.
This has been amazing. Thank you so much. And I've been reading the chat and everybody has been really impressed with all the information. So thank you so much. First of all, good.
You're very, very welcome. My pleasure. Thanks for the opportunity. I appreciate that.
So I have a couple questions here from the audience. So one person's asking, can you vape at one temperature and then revape at another temperature to get different molecules?
Sure, absolutely. I don't know if you can separate like, you know, very well, like with your at-home devices, they're in pretty small ranges, but there are very different boiling points, you know, but through each of the molecules, but you can't say this one boils here. Those boiling points are for pure molecules and not for complex mixtures. So there's things called azeotropes or all sorts of other physical chemistry problems that say, when I put this molecule in a mixture, it will not, you know, boil the same as when it's purely by itself. So I can get its boiling point and report that, and you can look it up on Wikipedia, but that doesn't mean that's where it's boiling inside of your cannabis. But you can get very different taste profiles at different temperatures, and you can certainly see different things happen from color when you do that in vaping. So the answer is yes, and it's kind of a fun thing to explore. But I don't know how finely you could control that, or if you could just pluck, you know, one or two molecules off your product at a time that way. So I don't want to over embellish that one.
I know that some people will sometimes vape and then they'll save their vaped cannabis and they'll use it for cooking. So kind of similar, but not
there's still exactly. Cannabinoids on there then, right?
Yeah. Next question is, cannabis hypermesis connected at all with the anaphylactic reaction? And have you ever read about anything about those being connected at all?
I don't know if they're connected, but I haven't heard them mentioned one in the same. So, you know, anaphylactic that's a horrifying thing. It's like, if you get stung by a bee, your, you know, lungs might close up and you can't breathe. I haven't heard anybody with hyperemesis saying, you know, they were having a very difficult time with breathing, or they were, you know, administered like epinephrine to kind of calm it down. It's been more along the lines of, you know, the hot shower or capsaicin rubs on the stomach or other ways to kind of go about managing the hyperemesis piece, which is more of the body wants it out, but it's not saying it's overreacted in a like an anaphylactic fashion to say that it's a real dangerous scenario to where you couldn't breathe. You know, terpenes can be irritants. That's some of the reason plants make them. And some people are certainly going to have, you know, allergic sensitivities to some cannabis or cannabis components. It's interesting when you grind it down, like we see a lot of people have a lot more problems with that type of allergic response than you do when you're just holding whole plant cannabis as well. So, you know, if you feel like you might be sensitive, you can rub some on your skin. You can try and get like a little indication of, does it itch? Does it turn red? Or start with a very slow amount, like very low amount, very small amount. When you're just, you know, if you're a first time cannabis user, especially if you're someone that's got seasonal allergies or other problems, you know, I don't know exactly which things, but there are some that are known to be sensitizers. Again, it's a compositional specific piece, but I haven't heard emesis, hyperemesis and anaphylactic pieces stuck together in the same conversation. Not to say there's no link, but I myself have not heard of that yet.
Okay, good answer. Here's another one too. People ask me all the time, how well do terpenes withstand the heat and the acid used in the manufacturing process, like edibles and stuff? And like, aren't they fragile compounds?
Yes, they are rather fragile compounds, I would say. They're delicate. They are, you know, volatile. So if you are going to heat things up, they most likely could leave. How much leaves, time and temperature is required to kind of get them to boil and disappear. So if I have a really, really hot surface and I put some on there, some might flash immediately, but others might stick around. Again, that's that complex boiling point type of problem. You know, could they disappear? They may not be exactly what I put in there. If my procedure is standardized enough, I might lose some, and I'm probably going to always smell some, but I'm hopefully losing about the same concentration as I was, you know, every single batch. So again, it might not be 100% of what I put in there, but it's consistent in that respects. I should be getting consistent output, even if it is only 50%. Now, you might wonder, in my testing lab, is my testing lab catching this, or how'd this all go wrong? There's a lot of scientific challenges in analyzing that the right way, but they, you know, they can definitely not survive the manufacturing process in a edible sense. Acids and other pieces can really start to degrade them too. So they are, you know, reactive, they're sensitive in some ways, some more so than others. So they can be subject to degradation based on their environment. So heat, light, temperature, acidic conditions can all be, you know, key degradants of those types of things.
Okay. What are your thoughts on non-cannabis derived terpenes being added back into vapes?
Yeah, I have no issue with that, provided they are well understood and you know exactly which ones you're adding them. And I think we do need to be careful that you don't generate a vitamin E acetate type of problem. So I'm more worried about THCO, THC acetate, and things like that, because that has a phenolic acetate, which is the same chemical structure that vitamin E acetate has. And, you know, can that degrade the same way to form ketene, which was the molecule that was reactive in the lungs? So, you know, that might be much, much more dangerous than the, was there a terpene that wasn't from cannabis? Yes, it's limonene. It's still the same limonene. That's fine. I think as long as it's the right molecules and the manufacturers are responsible and watching, you know, the terpene supply chain the right way, it can be fine. States have moved to understanding and forcing manufacturers to disclose which compositional like agents are used. So which molecules are present in your composition, at which concentrations are they? You know, the fine line between medicine and poison is dose. So there can be some that are fine at very small amounts, but they can be a problem at larger ones. So we might think that, you know, hey, this one's okay, right? And then all of a sudden, if it's 85% of my mixture, it's not okay. My lip was really irritated, or my airway was irritated. So, you know, I don't think many are advocating use large amounts of those. Like, certainly those that are, you know, providing terpenes for that purpose are often saying 10% of your vape cart concentration or less should be where you keep those. Hardware has worked today to say that, you know, it works pretty well with viscosity, so I don't need to use those to radically thin the products. But live resin extracts or high terpene extracts can have higher concentrations of those and may in fact be more irritating to some users. And again, those are not all pure cannabis components when I analyze the flower either. So I don't have a problem with putting things back together or putting them in there, provided you're watching it carefully, you know, you're paying attention, you're using them at the right concentrations, and we're using our best understanding of, you know, even the e-cigarette vape world as to what could be useful in that respects or not, and that you should avoid.
That's a great explanation. Thank you. Another question. This one's on hypermesis as well. So somebody's currently dosing themselves with 200 to 300 milligrams of concentrated oil per day. And this is something that they plan on doing for like a long-term period. Is there any advice of like what people can do to prevent cannabis hypermesis at all?
That's a tough one. I mean, it really is like use the least amount of cannabinoids as possible. One thing that can actually help you lower your cannabinoid requirement is the use of terpenes with that. So, you know, we see these CBD studies where they have large amounts of CBD and you're like, no one seems to use that much if there's a lot of other cannabis components or terpenes around. So one way of maybe backing down from that would be to perhaps introduce some terpenes to help with that. I'd say stay in close contact with a doctor. They're going to be the ones that have seen these things arise for people at which doses. I'm not a medical doctor and don't give medical advice. You know, I'm just a chemist. So I'm trying, you know, it's very difficult. I mean, some people might say that's my therapeutic need and I'm finding that. And I hope that this doesn't show up, but we couldn't tell you like, hey, in 5 years that might show up or 5 weeks it might show up. We don't know enough about that one just yet to say when it's going to arise. I think, you know, if that's where your minimum effective dose is and you're going to be required to do that, then I'd say, you know, discuss that with your doctor. They'll most likely say, you know, proceed with caution. If you see any sense of not feeling well or something's different, then immediately cease use. Go talk to your doctor again and try and, you know, work through that. There might be other cannabinoids you could switch in there, or using a broader amount of cannabinoids might mitigate, you know, the use of higher THC. And we don't know if it's only one of them that's responsible. We see it with a lot of high THC users, and we see it with a lot of folks that kind of use edibles too. So that we don't know if it's an oral metabolite and or you smoked a lot on top of that and did that. We just don't know enough about it. And we don't know if we could mitigate it with saying, well, we'll add a little bit more CBD, CBG, and some other ones. And you don't need so much of that one to get your medical benefits. And now you're at that regime where your body's still able to, you know, manage it without entering the hyperemesis realm. But I don't have a great answer for that one, unfortunately. I'm sorry.
Well, that was actually a good answer. So thank you. You know, like you said, we really don't know a lot about cannabis hypermesis. You know, we have an increasing number of people with cases, you know, and we're really trying to figure it out. And, you know, all we can do is pretty much what you explained. So that was great. Okay. So this is a good question. And maybe you could talk about some of the things that you have available through the workshop, but how would you suggest that a novice or a new user explore terpenes in a non-intimidating and easily digestible way? Don't you guys have like a terpene kit or something?
We
like
do
that?
Have an olfactory training kit. You know, that's certainly a way of kind of noticing them with your nose. I would recommend people do not handle pure terpenes. You know, they can be irritants to both the eyes, the skin, the airways, things of that type. I think there are some folks that sell isolated individual terpenes, and maybe some groups like doTERRA might have it with like a little dropper system. So you can try like one drop at a time. Be very, very careful with very small amounts to try and, you know, explore them. And, you know, use your nose and then put it on the product, I guess, if you're, you know, most of them are generally recognized as safe, especially for food. So there's no real problem in consuming them in an oral fashion. But in pure form and in concentrated form, you've got to handle those things very carefully. A very, very, very little bit, like a drop, can be a lot. It can go a very long way. It's really not something you want to embark on just like dumping a bunch of it here and there and trying to consume it. You really want to know what the concentration is. You could potentially dilute it into like an olive oil, vegetable oil, canola oil, MCT oil might be a great neutral carrier that you're like, great, I put like 10 drops in, you know, X in one cup of this, and I tried to taste some of it. You might be able to play around with it safely that way. But I would say, you know, trust your nose and kind of go down the, you know, olfactory sense first before I would try and start putting them everywhere else. Yeah. Be very careful if you're trying to handle them at home in any way.
Yeah, Definitely. And I'm just going to do two more questions. We keep on getting questions in because everybody is really interested in stuff, but we're going to just do two last ones. So what are the best terpenes from what you've heard for pain? Because that's a big condition that a lot of people use cannabis for.
Yeah, it's tricky. Like different pain is, you know, probably coming from different sources. So some folks may say THC helps for their pain. Some may say CBD helps for their pain. Some may say the cannabinoid acids are even better for that pain. Mm-hmm. So is there one magic terpene that way? I don't think there's one like that. You know, caryophyllene is known to have some CB2 activity, and that one, you know, look for ones that might have some of that around. I don't know if that's the magic pain killing terpene. I certainly wouldn't, you know, give it that. But maybe compositions that have pretty good amounts of that would be a good place to start. You know, that one might be as best a place as any when it comes to pain, but I don't know if there is one, you know, magic pain terpene. Again, it's the cannabis composition and what else is with it. If you had the same amount of caryophyllene that you do with THC, but you have caryophyllene with CBD, you might have very different pain responses because of what else is with it. So again, try and understand as much as you can on the products that you can access. But you know, maybe you start somewhere with caryophyllene or try to find some of that. It won't be hard to find ones with that one in there. Yeah. And just try to start discerning from that point, like, hey, it's caryophyllene plus this and this for me was what was working. It's your individual type of perspective that's going to be most informed there. And just try to get all the data that you can. But I don't know if there's one I would say is this one's great for pain. We don't really know that one just yet.
Perfect. And last question. So what is the workshop doing? What are you guys have coming up, and how can people get in touch with you?
On the web, on social media, the workshop, thewerkshop.com. Anyone can feel free to email me, jeff@theworkshop.com. You know, I'm happy to try to answer other questions or be a resource. We're working on standardized formulations. We help a lot of manufacturers and branded products try and create consistent compositions. A big part of that is through standardized terpene compositions, and then, you know, manufacturing cannabinoids in highly scalable and efficient economic ways to say, hey, look, these are great high purity components. When I put them together in consistent formulations, I can get good products. We've got a couple of, you know, new ways of coming out with infused pre-rolls. I think that's going to be an interesting one that's going to come to the market, where we've got solventless methodologies to try and say, here is a more consistent composition in a way that I can build from the great flower base that we all know. And just trying to get more understanding and better depth of broader compositions in terpenes, to just try and say, like, we're expanding our supply chain and our understanding of what we can get after, to say these formulations aren't just 5 or 10. We're using 50, 60 different molecules at once to really try and bring, you know, more of that cannabis ensemble and entourage effect. I'll be doing some other speaking events, you know, hopefully more things like this. And I think, you know, as the world kind of spins back up to where it kind of was, or at least the new normal, you know, we'll be engaged at some of the trade shows and some other speaking events for myself, probably more so next year. We didn't think that it was, you know, where everything was going to be just yet this year. But I think we're just going to continue on providing great formulation and assisting groups trying to get licenses in other states. If anyone needs any help in any way with a product development, product formulation, or licensing, or trying to get access to the market, you know, we're kind of connected to many. We don't own a state license ourselves, but we know testing labs, we know manufacturers, we know cultivators, we know dispensaries. We've been around a while, and we've got a pretty broad and vast network. If there's something you may need or some scientific resource, by all means, just let us know. We have a contact form on our website if you can't, you know, figure out how to get to us some other way, but we're pretty connected on social media, and we're always, you know, responsive. We do. Yes. We are told that we do at least reply to almost every question that's asked, and we try to. And if not, be persistent. We will eventually get there. And thank you to everyone for this opportunity, for paying attention, you know, this long, and supporting us in our efforts. We're just really hopeful that disseminating good information and great standardized products can really help benefit as many people as possible.
I totally agree. I love the workshop. I love what you're doing. And I just wanted to kind of, I forgot to ask one question, but I already know the answer. Someone was asking if you guys grow all the cannabis that you test. And the answer is that you guys collect it from other sources. And
correct. Yes. Yeah. We do not cultivate our own. No.
Yeah.
But we have a lot of really good friends that we trust very well, that we've gotten, you know, to know over the years, that are experts at cultivation. You know, I'm more of extraction because my thumbs are super brown. I wouldn't be the guy you want growing the plants, but, you know, hand over the ones you don't want to me. I'll take it from there. But we know, you know, we've gotten to know a lot of great cultivators that are, you know, really good at their craft. It's an amazing skill set that they've got. And I would not pretend to venture into that, but we just collect it from many others. So we're trying to take as broad a perspective of the cannabis world as you can from the consumer perspective. Because if I just have it from this narrow, I'm the grower, here's what I grew, and this is what I give you. Great, you told me about that, but how is that relevant to the rest of the world? How does that tell me about everything else in the cannabis sphere? You know, I think of it like a ball, really like a soccer ball. And we've got one, maybe two panels we've looked at, but it's this entire, you know, area that we've got yet to uncover. There's so much out there. I wouldn't want to say, like, I studied five plants that I grew myself and here's what we know about them. Great. That's helpful to the body of knowledge, but it's not 5,000. So can I get 50,000 or 500,000 data points? Now I might be able to give some, you know, better clues about which direction we could go or what our plant diversity really looks like. And it is exciting. Our diversity is going to get bigger and broader over many, you know, years to come. Now that we're licensing folks, they will breed for different things. They won't just have all the same stuff we're starting with. It's going to take some time, but, you know, I can assure you it is coming. We're starting to see different breeds for different reasons. Terpenes are going to be a great big piece of that. And, you know, we're going to have many, many other new and interesting physiological tools for many years to come, thankfully.
Yeah, no, I thanks can't to wait me. To see. Yeah. No, partly, of course.
I'll help, but I'm not the cultivator.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, I can't wait to say, and I say this to all of our guests, because we always talk about like what's coming in the future and stuff. But I can't wait to see, you know, where we get with the science and the research and being able to narrow down exactly what the terpenes and cannabinoids and all the other constituents do and being able to, you know, formulate something specifically for people. And that I think will come in the future eventually. So,
yep, we'll get there.
Very cool. Well, thank you so much for being our guest today. I always enjoy working with you, and thank you to your whole team at the workshop.
Thank you very much, Candice. I appreciate the opportunity, and thank you all for your attendance and your attention. If there's anything we can do to help, just let us know.
Very good. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you to Jeff. And then thank you to all of our viewers as well. I hope that we were able to share some information with all of you that will help you become better informed cannabis consumers, and that the information that we shared will help you find relief. Until next time, stay safe and well. Thank you, everybody.